Hey, Jenny, thanks for being on the show.
I am so excited to be with you today, Jay.
So I just love conversations with other entrepreneurs around this idea of building a business that lasts. And what I like to start out with is kind of getting a little perspective from you on your entrepreneurial journey. I feel like everybody kind of ended up in where they're at in business and entrepreneurship in a different way. But I also often find that many of us have similarities in the journey along the way. So tell me a little bit about kind of what you do and how you ended up where you are from an entrepreneurial journey perspective.
Sure. Well, I lead a coaching and training company for women entrepreneurs. I never really thought that I was going to be an entrepreneur. I always was into school and doing well and moving forward in my career, even when I was still in school, like getting the internships and you know, that was very important to me. I wanted to find work that I really loved. Like I just knew that that was critical, mission critical for me, and thought that the big dream, because my chosen career or what I thought it was going to be in school was public relations. Once I discovered that this thing called public relations was a career and a job, I dove right into that. Became a leader. I was at the University of Florida, became eventually the president of the PR Society on campus, and was going to, went to two national conferences. We were giving presentations there. I remember my senior year, we gave a talk, which is so interesting when I think about the theme of the talk, because I still do this in my business today. The theme was leadership retreats, because we had implemented leadership retreats in our chapter. We had the largest chapter in the nation. And, you know, we were like, you know, we were serious. We were serious. We weren't just these college students who were just playing around. We were really into this work. And that took me to New York City after I graduated. That was the dream. You know, I was living the dream. I was working at a big agency with big global clients. I was traveling. I was like 22 years old, going on business trips by myself, you know, for at that time, my main client was Kellogg, the cereal company. Yeah. And I remember going, oh my, like like there were some projects where the budget didn't allow a huge team. So it was me, because I was, you know, the cheapest labor. And so like, send her, you know, she can do it. And I would go do these projects and realize I could do it. You know, I could do these things and I could pull stuff off, not only by myself, but I knew how to enlist people into the vision. I knew how to get help, especially when we were in pretty interesting situations. I remember there's one example in my mind. We actually had this project. I haven't thought about this in so long. It was the Rice Krispie recipe sculpturing contest for schools. That's a mouthful. Rice Krispie recipe sculpturing contest for schools. And so basically Rice Krispie cereal sponsored this contest for schools, as elementary schools around the country, to create a sculpture out of Rice Krispie treats. And there was, that's, you know, amazing, certain rules that had to be followed, blah, blah, blah. And the winner would get, I think it was $10,000 for their school, plus a party when Snap, Crackle, and Pop would come to the party. Okay. And so this one year, the school that won was in Tennessee. And it just so happened that the party where you, and you have media, like our job as PR is to get the media to come cover this story. And then it gets blasted out and it becomes national news and all that. And it just so happened that there was like this crazy winter storm, and Snap, Crackle, and Pop, they couldn't get to the party. My client couldn't fly out because like flights were grounded, but I somehow got there. Like somehow I was able to get there, and I was the only one from my team. And the school, this was the biggest thing that ever happened in this town. They were just so thrilled. And I remember just giving the parents my credit card, like, go to your local store. The cereal didn't even get there. I was like, go to your local grocery store. Buy every box you can of, you know, and we pulled it off. And, you know, Snap, Crackle, and Pop got there a couple of days later. The parents helped us out and did. So you just figure it out, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that right there, unbeknownst to me at the time, that's the make, or that's the hallmark. That is what you need as an entrepreneur. You got to figure it out. It does not always go the way that you think it's going to go. Sometimes a giant ice storm comes in and there's nothing you can do about the ice storm. All you can do is respond. So, you know, that was my first taste of really big job life. And while it was interesting and I had wonderful people on my team and I had these big projects, and towards the end I was even working on a global piece of business and traveling to all these countries I'd never been to, and it actually I found sounded more glamorous than it really was. I realized that that wasn't what I was meant to do with my life. And that was a big heartbreak moment, because I mean, I was president of my PR society at school. You know, this, I was at one of the top agencies in the world. Now what am I supposed to do? And it wasn't like I could just go work at a different agency. There was nothing wrong with the agency. It was the work. It was the work that wasn't gratifying. And so I remember just going, I got to get out of here. Like, I just got to get out of here. It was that feeling like I'm trapped. I got to get out. And so that was the time when a lot of the resume websites were around, you know, I don't even know if they're still there, but hotjobs.com, monster.com. And I just splashed up my resume like SOS, you know, waving the white flag. Of course, my company found out that I was doing that too. And so that was an interesting conversation, you know, and they tried to get me to stay. We tried to work things out, but it was the work that wasn't a fit. And I think that's what we really, you know, when we find entrepreneurship, we realize that, gosh, we can create these companies around work that really matters to us and that can honor our values, and we can honor our desire for, you know, a certain type of a schedule. So I left that job though, and I went into a whole new career, which I didn't even know was a thing, called conference production. And this was where I was responsible for creating events, multi-day business conferences in the realm of customer service, customer management, marketing strategy, research, brand design. That was my favorite one, was brand design. And I had the opportunity to basically create a solution to a problem. Okay. Which is also a wonderful, I mean, that's basically what entrepreneurship is. That's what business is. You create solutions to problems and then you charge money to have people get the help. So my job was to conduct research with corporate leaders, get them on the phone, cold call, great skill, asking them, what are your biggest challenges? What's keeping you up at night? And, some of them obviously wouldn't take my call or just, you know, I got to go, I don't have time. Others, it was like business therapy. You know, they would just open up to me and I would convert all of what I would hear into a cohesive flow for an experience, a learning experience, 3-day conferences essentially. And my job was also to recruit the speakers. And so I would find people who could deliver talks on these topics. I also had budget for my larger events to recruit keynote speakers, hire them, pay them. And that job was a huge education for me. It was sink or swim. It was super stressful. It was all about profits. It was also the first time that I really started making big money, because I got a cut of the profits, which was lovely once I figured out what I was doing. But I got to see some big names on the stage, like Colin Powell and Tom Peters and Ken Blanchard and Tony Robbins, and just seeing, wow. These people, and there were mostly guys at that level, and I tried to find women. There just weren't a lot of women I could even choose from, which was frustrating as a woman. But they seemed to really enjoy what they were doing. They seemed to really enjoy what they were talking about. And towards the end of that gig for me, I just knew that I didn't like what I was doing enough and that there had to be another way. I just felt like a disconnect. And so I followed my curiosity and I honored my intuition, which is something we all need to do. We all need to trust ourselves there. And I decided to, after, you know, I thought about quitting that job for many years. I had an issue with the value system of the company and I had an issue with leadership. I learned a ton and I actually enjoyed the job. But once I stopped learning, you know, and once I felt like the things I'm learning from the leaders is how I want to be opposite, you know what I mean? I just knew, okay, something's got to give. And I signed up for a yoga teacher training, a 200-hour yoga teacher training. I had been practicing for about 6 years. It changed my life. It allowed my anxiety to go way down. Mm. It allowed me to make healthier choices. I, you know, stopped going out and being like horrible to my body and doing, you know, putting ridiculous things inside of my body. And I didn't know where that was going to take me. You know, I still had this very full-on career. But I just said, well, I'm going to find out. I'm going to do this for me, not worrying if this is going to turn into a career or anything. Just do it for me. And towards the end of that 3-month training, I just quit my job one day. I didn't have another job lined up. I didn't know I'm going to start my business now. I'm going to be a coach. Like, no, this was back in 2007. Things were very different back then. I wasn't even on Facebook yet. So I just did that. And I took some time off, which was an ego crusher. You know, my ego is flipping, like, because my value was rooted in how busy I was before and how much money I was making. I went from 6 figures to 0 figures in a day. And that was hard. That was really, really hard. But I had saved money. I had access to funds. I knew it wasn't a forever, you know, taking time off thing. It was just for, let me give myself the space and the grace to figure this out. Because I don't want to just go into some other job, because I'm still not getting to the root issue. The root issue was I'm not doing the work I'm here to do. And this schedule sucks. Like, I don't want to work like this. I want to be able to work from home. I want to be able to travel more. I needed a change. And through that time off, I met a woman who was a yoga teacher and a creativity coach. And once I heard, and I had heard coach because I had a lot of coaches kind of pitch me to speak at my conferences and stuff. I knew of it. Obviously, I'd been in sports in my life. I'm like, I know coach, but what exactly is this kind of coach thing? And once I dove in there, I said, I think that's it. I think that's it. And I'm going to sign up for a coach training and see. And that was the right road for me. And I built a business around helping. It was at the beginning, which is helping women in transition. I really was clear. I wanted to work with women because I know how how just scary and hard it is to be in transition and to do that alone, to feel like you're doing it alone. You feel something's wrong with you and you made a mistake and you should just be happy with the other thing, but you're not. And so then as I grew my business and really invested in working with coaches and going through trainings and being in masterminds and going to conferences, my business started growing and people came to me wanting help starting a business. So it's evolved into really working with female entrepreneurs, helping them, what I say, make money with their magic.
I love that. Now, what a cool story. You know, it's, I feel like the last couple of interviews that I've done have been like selfishly somewhat providential in some way, in that the last interview that I had, the guy was talking about exit planning for companies. And I, just to be clear for my team that might be listening, I have no intention of exiting. I love this company. I love the work that I get to do. But they know that one of the big things that I've been focused on over the last few years is what happens if I walk out in the street and get hit by a bus? What happens to the agency? How long does it last? That to me is the definition of success in my business, is how long will it survive when I'm no longer here for whatever reason. So that's one of the things we've been working on. One of my quarterly goals right now is to kind of clean up and finalize my exit plan in a worst case scenario, essentially, not even because I want to, but what happens if these things happen.
Yeah.
So that was providential. And then today with you, what's so interesting, because we've not met before, is a couple of things. One is, ironically, even though we're in the midst of not doing live events, we're in the process of planning our first live event for next March. So when I get stuck there, I'm going to come pick your brain for conference creation. And and then you went to UF, which is not far from me. I'm in St. Augustine, Florida. So not far at all. And for people that don't know, UF is in Gainesville, Florida. So
and I grew up in New Smyrna Beach, which is really not really far from St. Augustine.
How funny is that? So random. I love stuff like that. And I always dreamed of going to New York when I was younger and having that kind of job, but never actually did it. So it's what's so interesting to me about your story as you talk about it is that your transitions were not always, and really not even usually, defined by failure. They were defined by, I love the way you put this, following curiosity and honoring your intuition. Like, let's talk about that a little bit, because I think that's a really powerful idea. Number one, I think curiosity is so powerful. And I literally just said this to my team the other day when you said you just need to figure it out. I told my team, I said, you have the permission to figure it out.
Nice.
You have the, whatever that means, like you have that authority.
Yeah.
And I think that is the entrepreneur mindset. But let's talk about that a little bit, this idea of following curiosity and honoring intuition. Like, talk to me more about that.
Yeah. And I think we all were kids at one point. I have three kids and I watch the way that they move. And I remember the way I moved, you know, at that point. And then we get older and we get socialized and educated and kind of put over here in the way you're supposed to do it to, you know, check the boxes and everything. And we lose some of that curiosity because we're afraid of making a mistake and we're afraid of being made fun of and we're afraid of making a wrong turn. And that can just suck the life out of you. And so for me, and what I really practice and what I teach my clients to do is just to follow that piece of, I wonder what would happen if, I wonder what will happen when, and knowing that whatever we choose, it's not forever. Some people flip out and they're like, oh my, this is like the decision I make for the rest of my life. It's not. It's not. It's, if it's a right fit, great, keep going. But then maybe you'll need to tweak it. Maybe you'll need to be like, dude, that was interesting, but like, let's do a 180 now. Cause yeah, no. And that's okay. But we can't live our lives just, and it's interesting now as we're recording this in this lockdown mentality where I cannot shift because what might happen. I mean, the best inventions, the best innovations happen through that following of the curiosity. And, you know, I did, growing up in Florida, we had to do all these science projects. And at the time, I hated those projects. I like, oh God, the science project. And I didn't have the parents. My parents were divorced. I lived with my mom at that time. My mother did not help me with my science project. Like, I remember going to school with the kids and I'm like, I remember being like, does the teacher realize that this kid did not do the project? Like, the parents in the back with flashcards for the presentation. My mom doesn't even know what my topic's about. And the parents in the back with flashcards and the kids doesn't even know what they're saying. And so I'm going, wait, this isn't fair. Like, first off, that's a whole nother conversation. But it was, I thought I didn't like science projects, but once I realized I could start doing my projects on humans, which is what I did in my last few years of science projects, instead of like on metal. One year I did on, I was like, I don't even care about this topic. You have to research things that you care about, that you're passionate about. Yeah. And one year I did a project on who is better at video games, girls or boys. And I kind of picked two different, and I love that, which basically that's business, isn't it? It's a giant science experiment. You're working with humans. We're understanding human behavior. What gets someone to take the action to achieve the result that they say they want? It's very easy to say that you want something, but are you actually going to take the action to get there? Okay. And so for me, with the curiosity, I use this with my programs. I mean, I've been running basically my business. The revenue is the majority comes from group programs, group coaching programs, group training programs, and different kinds, different price points, kind of different lengths of time, different levels of access to me or the team, different levels of support. And I mean, those programs have changed so much since 2008, since I, you know, started my coaching business. And they have all come from me following my curiosity. I will get a download. This is the intuition. I'm very spiritual. I hear information. I have access to visions. I'm very clear audience. And so I'll hear things. I have a really powerful wind chime outside of my office. I live in Western Massachusetts now. And my sister actually died when I was in high school. She was in middle school. She died of cancer. And you know, that's also a piece of my intuition. And everyone has access, whether you had a family member die or not. We all have access to this powerful wisdom. And it's not necessarily things that are, quote, logical, things that you can see with your eyes. There are things that you can feel. There are things that you can hear, whether it be ancestors passing this to you. You know, we have angels protecting us. We have all of this energy, so much energy, and energy of nature. Are you kidding? You know, you live near the ocean. It's like that stuff is giving you so much. And when we are tuned in, we can receive that. It might be the name of one of your new offerings. It could be the visual look and feel of it. You're like, I just want this beach vibe. I want this, you know, there needs to be this word in there because that word evokes some kind of feeling, some kind of sensation. I mean, this really is brand building. Which was, that was my whole career, was in building brands. I still do that. I just do it for a different audience now. So, you know, when you follow your curiosity, it should scare you a bit, right? You want to walk that edge. of, you know, again, it's like, oh, I wonder what's going to happen when I go into the woods on this trail. Like my boys right now are so stoked because they just discovered this new trail to go on with their bikes. They're like, it's so cool, Mom. Like we just goes here and then we over here. And then, you know, just that feeling. And so even though we're, you know, adults now and, you know, we've got to be responsible and we've got, you know, these families to take care of and these teams and this company, when we follow our curiosity and we trust that small, still voice within, wow, that's when you know that you cannot lose. If anything, you're going to learn, and that's a beautiful thing.
So what do you feel like gave you the confidence to take the risks that you took when you took them? Because you had not just one transition, but several transitions, all of which are sacrificing, to some extent, a past vision, a past idea, a plan that was maybe in some cases going pretty well, but just didn't sit right with you. I think a lot of entrepreneurs resonate with that idea. And I feel like if you're a, I don't know if I can say it this way, but I will. If you're like a true-blooded entrepreneur, you know what that feels like. You go, this is not what I'm made for. And then there's an instance when you do something where you go, oh, this is it. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. How do I get more of that?
Yeah.
So what gave you that confidence to take those risks in those early days?
Yeah, I love that question. I simply knew then and still know now that time waits for no one. I learned that when Julie died. She was 12 years old. She was sick for a year. And until that last weekend before she died, I thought she was going to get better. Because that's what you do. Like no 12-year-old dies of cancer. I didn't know anyone. I didn't know anyone older than that, you know. And so that was this huge awakening for me. 6 months later, my best friend's brother died. Just tragically was killed. And then 2 years later, that best friend died. So this is a unique experience. I don't wish this on people, but I can't not have that, right? I had three deaths in 3 years from the time I was 16 to 19 years old. And that shapes you. Yeah. I do take more risks than the average person. What I did leaving that six-figure job without another job, I tell people, I don't recommend that. You know, that was, I pulled that off, but that wasn't easy. But I had no, at that point, I had no other option. I remember just like literally, I didn't walk into work that day going, I'm going to quit today. You know, I had thought about it for years, Jay, and I kept talking myself out of it. A carrot would get dangled in front of me. I'd get the carrot and then another carrot. I'd get the carrot. So are you really just going through your life to get the carrots, or do you want, the full garden? You know what I'm saying? And to realize that you're planting the garden, you can grow your own damn carrots. You don't need somebody giving you the carrot. And that was the thing. And so, you know, I really have a deep connection with my sister. I feel the presence of God. I just know that no matter what, all is well, is well. This thing doesn't work out, I'm freaking smart. I'll figure something else out. Like I just have that way about me, and it's been proven over and over again. Like that has been correct. And I think when you're wired as an entrepreneur, you will just freaking figure it out. Like you will figure it out. You will keep walking on that path and you will see this is worth my time. And this is not, you know, what, and I'm at the point now where it's very much, what are the activities that give me the highest return, not just financially, but you know, it's important obviously to look at that part, but what gives me the highest return from an enjoyment perspective, from, oh my gosh, I love talking to these people. I love running it like this. I love speaking about this material. And so that has been just a glorious part of this, is realizing we're designing it all. Like we are designing it all. This has been the most incredible personal growth path. And I may say to people, if you don't want that, I wouldn't recommend entrepreneurship, because it's going to crack you open and humble you and all the things. But I wouldn't trade these last, whatever, 12 plus years now for anything. And I also wouldn't trade that corporate experience for anything. It set me up beautifully for this. It really did. And I think that's a message I want everyone to get, is that everything that you've done, nothing has been a mistake. nothing has been a waste of time. Nothing has been, you know, just some weird fluke. It's all part of this, you know, matrix that you're in, mm-hmm. and it set you up perfectly for where you are now. And in order for you to get to that next level, you still have got to do things that freak you out.
I love that. I think that that is like kind of a lot of the root of entrepreneurship. Now, you know, I think a lot of times people say entrepreneurs are people who just take these wild risks. And I don't actually think that's true either. I think most successful entrepreneurs are people who have taken calculated, intentional risks. They've weighed the outcomes. They know what could possibly happen.
You need your calculator.
That's right. But they're not, but they're not living out of fear.
Right.
And I think, you know, as you told those stories about your childhood, like I started, you know, watering because it's dusty in here. And and I just thought, gosh, it's just another example of how I think in people's lives, sometimes our darkest days reveal the light ahead. Mm-hmm. And in the midst of them, we never want to relive them. Like, really. Like, we never, ever would want to feel the pain of those seasons of life. And frankly, the older we are, probably the more of those seasons we'll get to have. It's so interesting because I do really believe that some of the darkest days in my life have been the greatest blessings.
Absolutely.
And that is so hard to like swallow, but that's kind of what I hear out of your story is like, don't just write off all of those difficult, painful moments, but harness them for like what could be true now as a result of that.
Absolutely.
And especially if it's people that you've lost, how can I honor those people's memory, you know?
Yes. Yeah. I always say there's wisdom in those wounds. Wisdom in those wounds. If you're going through something now, I believe there's also a lot of power in just allowing yourself to be in it without, in my work too, I mean, I'm in the coaching industry. And so sometimes I feel like there's like, the people are speaking about things when they're still in the, they're still bleeding. And so allow yourself to get the support from healers and some from guides. You can keep things private. Once you get to the other side and you see, whoa, that's what that was. And you can speak from the place of, you know, the wisdom of the scar, the wisdom of the scar versus when you're, you know, when you're bleeding, when it's just really, really intense, that's when you see it. I was actually just having a conversation with my dad about this. You know, this, he had two daughters. I'm the one he's got left. And he has a stepdaughter too. But you know, he and my mom, they had two daughters. And my dad, actually, one of the things I did when I hadn't, you know, achieved the six figure, you know, the kind of thing that you want when you're in corporate. And then it took me several years to get there as an entrepreneur. You know, I also started having babies when I became an entrepreneur, balancing that, you know, just trying to figure it all out. And I had my dad help me one year when I said, okay, that's it. We are taking this business across the six figure mark. Like, is happening this year. And my dad worked for the IRS. He's an accountant. And so because the numbers thing was always kind of like the afterthought. I'm like, I just want to do the work, you know, and I love the work and I love connecting with people and sharing the message and da, da, da. But the numbers have to be handled. And so I couldn't use that as a crutch anymore. We started having regular conversations where I would share my numbers with him. He would ask me questions. I would ask him questions. I don't feel dumb asking my dad questions. Sometimes I would feel stupid asking questions of things that the terminology just would go over my head. I minored in business at UF, and I just remember taking like macroeconomics and business finance. And even now when I say them, I'm just like, you know, accounting, I'm like, you know, I'm like, I'm in the wrong building over here. I was majoring in PR. Those were my people. I'm glad I minored in business, but that material is so dry and it felt like really a foreign language. And so when I would talk to my dad, I didn't feel dumb. I didn't feel like, oh, I should know the answer to this and he's going to think I'm stupid. I could just say all those things. And that year, the business went over the six-figure mark. It was because I was having those regular conversations. I just reached out to him literally a few weeks ago and said, Dad, I want to start having these conversations again. You know, I've had different, you know, financial advisors and bookkeepers and blah, blah, but I need that. Like, I'm in order for us to get to that next level. Now he's retired. He's got all this time on his hands and he wants to help me. And I said to him, you know, Dad, I just think it's so interesting that this life that we've been living and the fact that you had a daughter die, I had my sister die. And so much of my message really is using your time well, Like, just that's really what it boils down to. Use your time well. I have a lot of different strategies I teach people around that. But that was the lesson from Julie. Use your time well. Live while you're alive. You want to go do something, do it. And here's how you can break down how to work with your energy and how to value your time and how to value your impact. And I just, again, what he and I wouldn't give to have her back, but I know she is doing this work with us. Like, I just know it. I just know it. And so for everybody who's had a hard thing, I mean, join the club. That's what humanity is. To be a human means you've just dealt with hardship, but that doesn't need to be your end. That is your beginning. That's the thing that you can just harness. And yeah, you can honor their lives. You can honor what you've gone through. A lot of it is kind of just healing from that trauma and turning it into this really powerful lesson for people. And you can turn it into a treasure.
Yeah, I love that. I think it's also, you know, I love when you're talking about the difference between working with somebody who is currently bleeding and somebody who already has the scar. And I think especially, I think this is one of the dangers in some faith-based communities that I've been in my life, is that it's very easy while somebody's in the midst of traumatic bleeding, you know, at least maybe emotionally or spiritually, and somebody's like, well, you know, God's got a plan for it, it's fine. And you're like, okay, yes, that's true, but, you know, there's a reason. Like, you know, my faith is really important to me. And so, like in the Bible, the shortest verse in the Bible is this. It says, Jesus wept. And I think that's really powerful, because the idea is basically, here's Jesus, who the Bible says is the God of the universe, and yet he's coming alongside these people and crying. Why? He was so powerful. He could have just been like, whatever, come back to life. It's all fine. But he doesn't. He leads by example, which is in the midst of those sorrows, weep with those people. And I think this is really important, too, in thinking about team members on your own team, because one of the hardest things about growing a business is growing a team well. And, you know, I think empathy is not an inherent strength for me. It's something I have to pay attention to. I have to be aware of. I can be a bulldozer if I'm not careful. And really taking that moment to go, hey, are you okay? Versus like, why are you doing this? And why are you doing that? And what's wrong with this? Those things are just so interesting to me. I also love what you're talking about with your dad, because I think that idea of having somebody to look up to, somebody who's going to kind of help guide you along, and that intentional growth. You talked about having consistent calls and consistent meetings. That intentionality is where a lot of people fall off the wagon.
Yeah, totally. Totally. And it's just, and it's allowing yourself to be vulnerable and say, I want help here. And kind of, especially when it's your numbers, like, I'm going to open this up to you. Don't yell at me, okay? Like, I don't know. Are you going to judge me? Am I in trouble? It's like, no, I'm a grown woman. He wants to help. And whether it's your numbers, whether it's, you know, I mean, I have a therapist I work with who, thank God for her. And I really consider her my business therapist, because, and that's another piece that I wish more people would talk about. Of course, coaching is critical. I am one. But I couldn't be where I am if I wouldn't consistently get under the hood and look, get to the root. What is this? Like, what's going on here? Because you start noticing patterns and themes and trends about why empathy is so hard, or why this thing keeps going on. And that takes a tremendous amount of vulnerability to say, here's where I am. It's very easy to kind of tiptoe around, like, everything's good. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. Like, we are a society of doers. We're really good human doings. But when we get deeper into that, I mean, it was, I don't know, a week or two ago, and I was talking to my therapist, and we now talk, we used, you know, we're now like once a month, and it's just this nice tune-up where, again, I'm a great doer. Like, I know how to get into action like anyone's business. And so I'm like, and then boom, I'm like, and then there's this thing. And so that comes out, and we get to the root. Before I know it, I'm crying. I'm like, that's what it is. And it's this, you know, it's been with me since forever. And then you realize that's been your come from, that's been your crutch, that's been the thing that's been shielding you from the thing that you say that you want. Because what we all really want is love. We want love, we want connection, we want acceptance. But these habits that we have, that maybe we needed to have to protect us when we were younger from people who might hurt us, mm-hmm. people who didn't have our best interests at heart. We didn't have full autonomy over ourselves. You know, we didn't live on our own yet. We didn't have like financial control, all that. But now we're adults and we're still using some of those same techniques, and they're not actually helping us. They are keeping us away from the things that we say that we want. All right. And so our willingness to just open up and to do it with someone who's trustworthy doesn't mean we need to, like, again, social media is a wonderful thing, and it can also be a dangerous tool where you're kind of just throwing up, you know, you're like, oh, that you need to, let's get that over here, because you're not going to get the help that you want. Okay. Like, the comment section is dangerous. Okay. That's right. Like, that's not what, no. And so, you know, you have to be so wise and mature. And I do see some lack of that, just because someone's quote a good entrepreneur, it doesn't mean that there's maturity there. It doesn't mean that there's, you know, some strong wisdom there, and eventually that will catch up to you. And so just really, I think everyone, if you get honest about what do I need just in this season, not like for the rest of my life, you know, just in this season. And that's something I very much practice in my work and who I am as a woman, and this can be done by anyone, no matter your gender. But what season are you in? Like literally, what season are you in? And then what season is nature in? Because when we can get in sync with the season of nature, we know what's going on out there. We have a stronger sense of what's going on inside of us. And then we can better honor our own true nature. It's when we disconnect from that and we just live our life through machines and technology and like go, 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 and why didn't this get done, that's unsustainable. That's not how nature works. I live in the woods now. I live in this gorgeous forest. All I see are green trees right now. I love it. Absolutely love it. I do miss the ocean, but this is good. This is really good. And I learn so much from nature, and it really allows me to be a wiser businesswoman.
You know, one thing, this one little point that I want to transition about, talk about work-life balance a little bit. I thought when you're talking about, like, you know, having a therapist or counseling, and just in general, is a really important idea for people, because I think there's some shame in the idea that I have a therapist or I go to counseling or whatever. And it always reminds me of this old quote that Zig Ziglar used to say. And he would say something like this. He said, people always say that when they're down, they put in one of my tapes and it makes them feel better. And I always ask them, why do you wait until you're down to start feeling better? Totally. And I was like, man, that's so good. And that's basically the idea here, is like, you don't have to be having problems in business to have a counselor, or problems personally to have a therapist, or having problems in your marriage to have a therapist. Maybe, just maybe, if we were to do some of those things before we have major problems, maybe that would help give us the tools and resources that when we encounter those problems, we know what to do with them. Totally. I think that's really important. I want to transition, because one of the things you talked about earlier was, as you were transitioning to entrepreneurship, you're also balancing babies. And that's a real thing. Parenthood is no joke. And so anybody that's not had kids yet, it's no joke. It's a lot of work. It's a whole different job altogether. I have five of them who range from 7 to 15. Wow. And so this idea of work-life balance matters a lot to me. That term means something different to everyone. I also think it is very different seasons of your life. Mm-hmm. So I'd love to hear from you. Number one, what does it even mean to you? And number two, how have you learned to adapt to your own rhythms over time to find, you know, what is the right place for the season that you're in?
Yeah. And you're right. It depends on how many children you have, how old they are, what your work situation looks like. But what I knew instinctively, it's so interesting when I look back, I remember in that last corporate job, and my last boss, I love her. I learned a tremendous amount from her. She had four kids. And I remember just being like, I couldn't do what she's doing. I couldn't do it. You know, she worked from home 2 days a week, but I'm just like, I'm stressed just even contemplating this. And I don't think I could do that. I literally, my body was opposed to getting pregnant in that environment. Okay. And so that was a piece of it, that those babies they kind of started knocking on the door of my soul. And I didn't grow up thinking I wanted to have kids. I was like, I don't know. I'm a career girl. I'm heading up, you know, I'm doing that. I'm not relying on anyone. I'm just doing my thing. And could have been my parents were divorced, didn't have great examples of like that marriage thing going. My sister died. I was like, let me just shield myself from all of that. Okay. I can control work.
Yeah, that's right.
Which works until it doesn't. And then, you know, I just felt like, well, maybe I am supposed to be a mother. And I met my husband and thank goodness I was kind of had changed my whole life. And so I had control over my schedule. And so my first son was born. Then my second one came along and now I have my third, I have my daughter. And it's been an evolution, absolutely. And it's interesting when I look back when my first son, I mean, that was like that was in New York City. And it was amazing to have a baby there, but also kind of lonely. You're in these giant apartment buildings and it's not, we didn't have family really nearby and you're, don't know really what you're doing other than I'm going to keep this creature alive. And I joined a new mom support group. And that was a game changer for me. It was at the prenatal yoga center in the Upper West Side. And the entrepreneur in me noticed that, oh my God, they're getting all these phone calls because it was just one room. It wasn't a separate lobby. And the person would answer the phone and go, yeah, you know, we do have a support group. Good. It's full. We can get you in like 2 months. And I'm going, she can't wait 2 months. She needs it now. Plus she may be going back to work. A lot of women in New York go back to work. There's a lot of career driven women, plus financially, sometimes they have to. And I'm thinking there has to be a solution to this. And so I ended up partnering with another organization and bringing more new mom support groups to New York City. I started leading those. That was my first taste of like group coaching. And then I brought that online once I learned about online marketing. And so motherhood cracked me open to just a new way of doing business. And that realization that women, when women gather, magic happens. And the same thing happens when men gather, or when like an intentional group of people gather with a desire for transformation, a desire for connection. And so I started, you know, leading those things. And so the whole thing was, again, what will give me the biggest return on my time, on my time. That's been my driving force this whole journey. When I'm not with my, at first it was just that son, and I should note that I was doing freelance work in my last corporate career. Once I quit, I was training to become a coach. I was taking on some one-on-one clients. I was doing freelance work. And an old manager of my company went to head up a different company. She wanted to hire me full time. I wasn't interested. I was very clear with her. I'm training to become a coach. I'm going to build this business, but I'm happy to consult with you and work on these projects, which was nice because it brought in, you know, money. It brought in like sure bet money. And I was able to do that while, you know, I'd have a babysitter come in and look after my son in the apartment. But that was also another wake-up call for me, as I said, I don't like this work enough. And when I'm not with this beautiful child, I have to do work that I love, period, period. Like that is my benchmark. And so if something does not get that level, we got to release it. We got to figure out how to replace that income. And so I've just followed that. Like that, my definition of balance is when I'm not with my kids, am I doing work that I love? Like, that's it. And if the answer is yes, then I know I can teach them how to do work that they love. And right. What's fascinating is this is something that I'm now teaching on. I started homeschooling my kids, my husband and I, before this pandemic. It was a few years ago when our oldest son, he was in second grade at the time, he's now in fifth, basically refused to go to school. About 1 month into second grade, I was shocked. I'm like, what is going on here? And he was very clear. I want to be homeschooled. He would not deviate from this. We took him to tour other schools. He's like, these schools are very nice. I will not be going here. I will be homeschooled. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Okay. But then I look at him, I go, well, of course, this is my son. Like, I'm very clear with what works for me. Who is my husband? Are we surprised that we have a child who knows what works for him? That's wonderful. Okay. So we need to adapt. And that a few years ago was like a huge, when you talk about balance, that's when I had to really tighten up and say, okay, you know, I thought I was using my time well before. Well, now I have like half of it because I don't have the kids out at school, or, you know, we had a daycare provider at the next door neighbor. So lucky. I had to really tighten up and say, okay, now I've got half of the work time. So what can I do within that time? Because my son needs me. He needs this. He needs this experience. I don't know why, you know, this is hard. I don't know how I'm going to pull this off, but we've done it. And it's wild because, you know, this is the whole kind of spiritual conversation, but when we were still living in New York City, we were wanting to move. We didn't know where to move. And it was a real struggle. And I know there could be people watching right now or listening going, yeah, I want to move. I don't know where to go. And we had the same thing. We looked at so many pieces of real estate. I would have gone anywhere. I'm like, I'm done. I've graduated. I'm all set. Like, we need to go someplace else. My husband, he makes decisions differently than I do. And so we had come up to this area. His parents had a vacation home here, and we would come here. We got married here. It's beautiful. I didn't think people lived here. I thought they just had, you know, they were retirees. It's a ridiculous thought, but you don't know. And so, and I didn't think people with young families lived here. I was like, these are just older people, you know, they're retirees. And I met this woman at the lake one day with her son. I had my son, and my Stephen and I had just gone to a couple's retreat. Talk about, you know, really investing in your relationship and your marriage. We had just celebrated 5 years of marriage. And we went to this couple's retreat, and we were like, that's it. We're going to figure out where we're going to go. Because we had this false belief that if we moved out of New York, we would regret it. And it would be a mistake. And I would become like a Stepford wife, and it would just be bad. And we would kind of lose our edge. And we went to this retreat. We kind of realized, no, we can do this. We're going to do it. We're not going to be afraid. We're not going to live our lives in fear. And I went to the lake with my mother-in-law and my son. Steve went to play golf. I met this woman who was pushing her son on the swings, same age as my son. We get talking. She shared with me they'd moved there from New York City, and she owned a business and she ran it from home. I'm like, what? Like, what? And it was like a wellness nutrition company. I'm like, oh my God. And I literally like Googled her and tracked her down, and because the seed was planted. And I think we're supposed to move here. My mother-in-law heard the conversation. She goes, I think you're supposed to move here. You're like, I know. And within a week, we had decided we're going to do it. We're going to move. We sublet our apartment in the city. My husband was on board, but he was scared. So we sublet the apartment. You know, like, if it's, quote, a mistake, we'll do it for a year. You can always come back. That's the whole thing, you guys. Do something. If it doesn't work,
yeah, that's right.
And then, get this, the lady lives a street away from me. Her company has got a great company. She's since hired me during when this pandemic started happening. She's now hired me to teach her. They have corporate wellness clients to speak on the topic of homeschooling while working from home. Like, that's, you can't funny. Make this up, you know? And yeah. So our paths are so interesting. And the thing that you're like, why is this happening to me? This is so hard. I can't do this. Just trust. You might not get that payoff like right away, but it just trust, allow yourself to just be in a life that you go, wow, I never thought I'd be here, but it's actually really great.
and ironically, we actually homeschool as well. So all five of our kids are homeschooled, and it's, it was quite a blessing going into this pandemic because our life, frankly, was not disrupted that much.
Totally.
Like, we just kind of carried on because it was the same thing we always do. And I felt really horrible for all the parents who had to deal with like 27 different teachers, and all the teachers are trying to figure out online stuff, and then they're trying to duplicate what they do in a classroom and Zoom. And you can't really do that. And
no.
Oh, mercy. So I was really blessed. And I actually was homeschooled as well through fifth grade anyway. So,
wow.
So a lot of commonality there. I love those stories. That's so interesting. And I think just the ideas, that you're sharing, I think as you kind of rounded out there at the end was really important, which is, look, you can try something and it might not work, and that's okay. And then you can go back to some other thing, but at least you know that you tried. I think that the biggest pain that people can experience is regret. And, you know, we are, you know, most people watching this are blessed enough to live in a country that, or a place that they can take those kind of risks. And there's so many opportunities now that the internet creates for us that didn't exist for our parents or their parents. Like the access to people, especially in the midst of what we're all dealing with right now, we wouldn't be able to even do what we're doing right now.
Totally. You know?
And it's just wild. As we round out, there's two last things that I always like to kind of hear about. Number one is, if people want to find more about you and what you do and your coaching, where online can they do that? And number two, any parting thoughts that you have as you kind of round out and speak into the lives of entrepreneurs around building a business that lasts? Where can they find you? And parting thoughts on building a business that lasts?
Awesome. My home base is my website, jennyfennig.com. That is my name, jennyfennig.com. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Facebook. Just search for my name. You will find me. If anyone wants help with the whole time piece, I can offer a free resource for your listeners, if that's okay.
Yeah,
jennyfennig.com/schedule. jennyfennig.com/schedule. That's a time template to help you reclaim your time and to really teach you some of these concepts of task batching, time chunking, and just, you know, because I just think the biggest crutch in life is I don't have time. It's like, yes, you do. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do. We all, when you commit to using it more wisely, you absolutely do. You have plenty of time. I always say to my clients, you've got plenty of time. You got plenty of money. Like, it's just a reframe. It's a reframe because it's all around us when we don't squander it. Okay. And then, you know, something that I just will speak into everyone is that you have magic inside of you. Hmm. You literally are this gorgeous concoction of bones and dust and blood and wonderful dreams and ideas and a unique vibration. Your essence has never existed in the world. Like, your combination of what makes you, you, nobody else has it. And so don't waste your days comparing what so-and-so's doing or this person has that and blah, blah, blah. That you compare and you despair. And it is such a waste. If you share your song, you know, what I say to my people, those of y'all, you know, you're growing your businesses. What I would say to my clients is one of your jobs when you grow your business, you want to grow a business that lasts, you got to bang the drum. You got to bang the drum. That is your job. It's not enough to do wonderful work. My sense is that people who are listening, you are masters of your craft. Okay. I'm a master of my craft. I work with people who are masters of their craft and they delight in being incredible at what they do. That's not enough. You have got to bang the drum about what you do and why. You have to enroll people in the mission. You got to share those stories. You got to be an incredible storyteller and a connector. And if you think, oh, what if someone is going to get upset because I sent an email, you know, or I put the thing out and I work with a lot of my people on that. It's like, that's your job. Like, that literally, you know, if you ever worked at a company, you had a job, you had certain things you had to do. But then when you have your own company, like, who's telling you? You're telling you. You're getting the, you know, you're getting the downloads from your higher power. You got to do it. That's your job. You will, your edge will be pushed. And that's a good thing. That is a beautiful thing. So I send you all so many blessings and all the good vibes as you build a business that lasts.
I love that idea of when you compare, you despair, and ultimately there's magic inside of you. That's just a really encouraging thing to round out our conversation on. Jenny, thank you so much for your time today. I know it's been encouraging to me, and I think it will be for those who listen as well.
Awesome. Thank you for the opportunity.
Hey, I hope this video has helped you with some tips and ideas to build a business that lasts. Make sure you subscribe to our channel so that you don't miss out on the next videos that we roll out. And more importantly, for some awesome free resources, head over to our website at buildingabusinessthatlasts.com. You can get a free copy of my book there where I tell you how I have built an agency that's grown year over year for the last 20 years in a row. So go grab that, buildingabusinessthatlasts.com, and make sure to subscribe to our channel. Thanks. We'll see you soon.